start our recording, and let's change our playlist over. And let's go ahead and get started. As you can see, we are about halfway through the book already. And we are starting on chapter 10. Chapter 10. Someone was hammering against an anvil somewhere very, very close to her head. So close that she felt each beat in her body, the sound shattering through her mind, stirring her from sleep. With a jolt, Selena sat up. There was no hammer and no anvil, just a pounding headache. And there was no assassin's fortress, only endless miles of red dunes and Casita standing watch over her. Well, at least she wasn't dead. Cursing, she got to her feet. What had Ansel done? The moon illuminated enough of the desert for her to see that the assassin's fortress was nowhere in sight, and that Casita's saddlebags were full of her belongings. Except for her sword. She searched and searched, but it wasn't there. Selena reached for one of her two long daggers, but stiffened when she felt a scroll of paper tucked into her belt. Someone had also left a lantern beside her, and it only took a few moments for Selena to get it lit and nestled into the dune. Kneeling before the dim light, she unrolled the paper with shaking hands. It was in Ansel's handwriting, and wasn't long. "I'm sorry it had to end this way. The Master said it would be easier to let you go like this, rather than shame you by publicly asking you to leave early. Casita is yours, as is the Master's letter of approval, which is in the saddlebag. Go home. I will miss you. Ansel." Selena read the letter three times to make sure she hadn't missed something. She was being let go? But why? She had the letter of approval, at least. But what had she done that made it so urgent to get rid of her, that he'd drug her and then dump her in the middle of the desert? She had 5 days left. He couldn't have waited for her to leave? Her eyes burned as she sorted through the events of the past few days for ways she might have offended the Master. She got to her feet and rifled through the saddlebags until she pulled out the letter of approval. It was a folded square of paper sealed with sea green wax, the color of the Master's eyes. A little vain, but... Her fingers hovered over the seal. If she broke it, then Arabin might accuse her of tampering with the letter. But what if it had said horrid things about her? Ansel said it was a letter of approval, so it couldn't be that bad. Selena tucked the letter back into the saddlebag. Perhaps the Master had also realized that she was spoiled and selfish. Maybe everyone had just been tolerating her. And maybe they'd heard of her fight with Ansel and decided to send her packing. It wouldn't surprise her. They were looking out for their own, after all. Never mind that for a while, she had felt like one of their own. Felt, for the first time in a long, long while, like she had a place where she belonged, where she might learn something more than deceit and how to end lives. But she'd been wrong, somehow realizing that hurt far worse than the beating Arabin had given her. Her lips trembled, but she squared her shoulders and scanned the night sky until she found the stag and the crowning star that led the north. Sighing, Selena blew out the lantern, mounted Casita, and rode into the night. She rode toward Exandria, opting to find a ship there instead of braving the northern trek across the singing sands to Yerpa, the port she'd originally sailed into. Without a guide, she didn't really have much of a choice. She took her time, often walking instead of riding Casita, who seemed as sad as she was to leave the silent assassins and their luxurious stables. The next day, she was a few miles into her late afternoon trek when she heard the thump, thump, thump. It grew louder, the movements now edged with clashing and clattering and deep voices. She hopped onto Casita's back and crested a dune. In the distance, at least 200 men were marching, straight into the desert. Some bore red and black banners, Lord Beric's men. They marched in a long column, with mounted soldiers galloping along the flanks. Though she had never seen Beric, a quick examination of the host showed no signs of the Lord being present. He must have stayed behind. But there was nothing out here. Nothing except for... Selena's mouth went dry. Nothing except for the assassin's fortress. A mountain soldier paused his riding, his black mare's coat gleaming with sweat. He stared toward her. With her white clothes concealing all but her eyes, he had no way of identifying her, no way of telling what she was. Even from the distance, she could see the bow and quiver of arrows he bore. How good was his aim? She didn't dare to move. The last thing she needed was the attention of all those soldiers on her. They all possessed broadswords, daggers, shields, and arrows. This definitely wasn't going to be a friendly visit, not with this many men. What was that why the master had sent her away? Had he somehow known this was going to happen and didn't want her caught up in it? Slana nodded to the soldier and continued riding towards Xandria. If the master didn't want anything to do with her, then she certainly didn't want to warn them, especially since he probably knew. And he had a fortress full of assassins. 200 soldiers were nothing compared to 70 or so of the Sezi Sucast. The assassins could handle themselves. They didn't need her. They'd made that clear enough. Still, the muffled thump of Cassita's steps away from the fortress became more and more difficult to hear. The next morning, Xandria was remarkably quiet. At first, Selena thought it was because the citizens were all waiting for news about the attack on the assassins, but she soon realized she found it quiet because she had only seen it on market day. The winding, narrow streets that had been crammed with vendors were now empty, littered with errant palm fronds and piles of sand that slithered in the fierce winds from the sea. She bought passage on a ship that would sail to Amir, the port in Melisande, across from the Gulf of Oro. She'd hoped for a ship to Inish, another port, so she could inquire after a young healer she'd met on her journey here, but there were none. And with the embargo on ships from Xandria going to other ports, other parts of Adderland's empire, a distant, forgotten port like Amir would be her best. From there, she'd travel on Cassita back to Rifthold, hopefully catching another boat somewhere on the long arm of the Avery River that would take her the last leg to the capital. The ship didn't leave until high tide that afternoon, which left Selena with a few hours to wander the city. The spider silk merchant was long gone, along with the cobbler and the temple priestesses. Nervous the mare would be identified in the city, but more worried that someone would steal Cassita if she left her unguarded, Selena led the horse through back alleys until she found a near private trough for Cassita. Selena leaned against a sandstone wall as her horse drank her fill. Had Lord Beric's men reached the fortress yet? At the rate they were going, they would probably arrive this night or early tomorrow morning. She just hoped the master was prepared, and that he had at least restocked the flaming wall after the last attack from Beric. Had he sent her away for her own safety, or was he about to be blindsided? She glanced up at the palace towering over the city. Beric hadn't been with his men. Delivering the mute master's head to the king of Adderlin would surely get the embargo lifted from a city. Was he doing it for the sake of his people, or for himself? But the Red Desert also needed the assassins, and the money and the trade the foreign emissaries brought in too. Beric and the master had certainly been communicating in the past few weeks. What had gone wrong? Ansel had made another trip a week ago to see him, and hadn't mentioned trouble. She'd seemed quite jovial, actually. Selena didn't really know why a chill snaked down her spine in that moment, or why she found herself suddenly digging through the saddlebags until she pulled out the master's letter of approval, along with the note Ansel had written her. If the master had known about the attack, he would have been fortifying his defenses already. He wouldn't have sent Selena away. She was Adderlin's greatest assassin, and if 200 men were marching on his fortress, he'd need her. The master wasn't proud, not like Erebin. He truly loved his disciples. He looked after and nurtured them. But he'd never trained Ansel. Why? And with so many of his loved ones in the fortress, why send only Selena away? Why not send them all? Her heart beat so fast it stumbled, and Selena tore open the letter of approval. It was blank. She flipped the paper over. The other side was also blank. Holding it up to the sun revealed no hidden ink, no watermark. But it had been sealed by him, hadn't it? That was his seal on the... It was easy to steal a signet ring. She'd done it with Captain Rolf. And she'd seen the white line around the master's finger. His ring had been missing. But if Ansel had drugged her and given her a document sealed with the master's signet ring... No, it wasn't possible. And it didn't make sense. Why would Ansel send her away and pretend the master had done it? Unless... Selena looked up at Lord Beric's place. Unless Ansel hadn't been visiting Lord Beric on behalf of the master at all. Or maybe she had at first, long enough to gain the master's trust. But while the master thought she was mending the relationships between them, Ansel was really doing quite the opposite. And that spider silk merchant had mentioned something about a spy among the assassins. A spy working for Beric. But why? Sorry, I forgot to silence my watch. It was just my brother texting me. Okay. The story. Why would Ansel send her away and pretend the master had done it? And then And that spider silk merchant had mentioned something about a spy among the assassins. A spy working for Beric. But why? Selena didn't have time to ponder it. Not with 200 men so close to the fortress. She might have questioned Lord Beric, but that, too, would take precious time. One warrior might not make the difference against 200, but she was Selena Sardothian. That had to count for something. That did count for something. She mounted Cassita and turned her toward the city gates. Let's see how fast you can run, she whispered to the mare's ear, and took off. And that was chapter 10. Hi, Cody. Yes, I saw your text message. Yes, I saw you got a new car. I'm very happy for you. Oh, goodness. This book. But yes, Cody, you caught me on a reading stream. I do not read chat while I am reading the book. I only read chat in between chapters. Let's see. Where are we at? 11, 12. Also, Cody, yes, that is Mom. LaMomda1525 is indeed Mom. I made her a Twitch account. And she tunes into all of my reading streams and sometimes my other streams as well. She's a true fan. She's subscribed. Cody, tisk tisk. Not even subscribed? Fake fan. This is a joke, by the way. Anyways, I love you too, Cody. Let's move on to chapter 11. Like a shooting star across the red sky, Cassita flew over the dunes and made the jump across the cleaver as if she were leaping over a brook. They paused only long enough for the horse to rest and fill up on water, and though Selena apologized to the mare for pushing her so hard, Cassita never faltered. She, too, seemed to sense the urgency. They rode through the night until the crimson dawn broke over the dunes and smoke stained the sky, and the fortress spread before them. Fires burned here and there, and shouts rang out, along with the clashing of weapons. The assassins hadn't yielded yet, though their walls had been breached. A few bodies littered the sand leading up to the gates, but the gates themselves showed no sign of a forced entry, as if someone had left them unlocked. Selena dismounted Cassita before the final dune, leaving the horse to either follow or find her own path, and crept the rest of the way into the fortress. She paused long enough to swipe a sword from a dead soldier and tuck it into her belt. It was cheaply made and unbalanced, but the point was sharp enough to do the job. From the muffled clopping of hooves behind her, she knew Cassita had followed. Still, Selena didn't dare take her eyes away from the scene before her as she drew her two long daggers. Inside the walls, bodies were everywhere, assassin and soldier alike. Otherwise, the main courtyard was empty. It's little rivers now, flowing red. She tried her best not to look too closely at the faces of the fallen. Fire smoldered, most of them just smoking piles of ash. Charred remnants of arrows revealed that they'd probably been ablaze when they hit. Every step into the courtyard felt like a lifetime. The shouts and clanging weapons came from other parts of the fortress. Who was winning? If all the soldiers had gotten in with so few dead on the sand, then someone had to have let them in. Probably in the dead of night. How long had it taken before the Night Watch spotted the soldiers creeping inside? Unless the Night Watch had been dispatched before they could sound the alarm. But as Selena took step after step, she realized that the question she should be asking was far worse. Where is the Master? That was what Lord Beric had wanted, the Master's head, and Ansel. Selena didn't want to finish that thought. Ansel hadn't sent her away because of this. Ansel couldn't be behind this, but... Selena started sprinting for the Master's greeting room, heedless of the noise. Blood and destruction were everywhere. She passed courtyards full of soldiers and assassins locked in deadly battle. She was halfway up the stairs to the Master's room when a soldier came rushing down them, his blade drawn. She ducked the blow for her head and struck low and deep, her long dagger burying itself into his gut. With the heat, the soldiers had forgone metal armor, and their leather armor couldn't turn a blade made with Adirlanian steel. She jumped aside as she groaned. He groaned and tumbled down the steps. She didn't bother sparing him a final look as she continued her ascent. The upper level was completely silent. Her breath sharp in her throat, she careened toward the open doors of the greeting room. The 200 soldiers were meant to destroy the fortress and provide a distraction. The master could have been unguarded with everyone focused on the attack, but he was still the master. How could Ansel expect to best him? Unless she used that drug on him as well. How else would she be able to disarm him and catch him unawares? Selena hurled herself through the open wooden doors and nearly tripped on the body prostrate between them. Mikhail lay on his back, his throat slit, eyes staring up at the tiled ceiling. Dead. Beside him was Ilias, struggling to rise as he clutched his bleeding belly. Selena bit back her cry, and Ilias raised his head, blood dripping from his lips. She made to kneel beside him, but he grunted, pointing to the room ahead, to his father. The master lay on his side atop the dais, his eyes open and his robe still unstained by blood. But he had the stillness of one drugged, paralyzed by whatever Ansel had given him. The girl stood over him, her back to Selena as she talked, swift and quiet, babbling. She clenched her father's sword in one hand, the bloodied blade drooping toward the floor. The master's eyes shifted to Selena's face, then to his son. They were filled with pain, not for himself, but for Ilias, for his bleeding boy. He looked back to Selena's face, his sea-green eyes now pleading, "Save my son." Ansel took a deep breath, and the sword rose in the air, making to slice off the master's head. Selena had a heartbeat to flip the knife in her hand. She cocked her wrist and let it fly. The dagger slammed into Ansel's forearm, exactly where Selena had aimed. Ansel let out a cry, her fingers splaying. Her father's sword clattered to the ground. Her face went white with shock as she whirled, clutching the bleeding wound. But the expression shifted into something dark and unyielding as she beheld Selena. Ansel scrambled for her fallen blade. But Selena was already running. Ansel grabbed her sword, dashing back to the master and lifting it high over her head. She plunged the sword toward the master's neck. Selena managed to tackle her before the blade struck, sending them both crashing to the floor, cloth and steel and bone twisting and rolling. She brought her legs up high enough to kick Ansel. The girl split apart, and Selena was on her feet the moment she stopped moving. But Ansel was already standing, her sword still in her hands, still between Selena and the paralyzed master. The blood from Ansel's arm dripped to the floor. They panted, and Selena steadied her reeling head. "Don't do it," she breathed. Ansel let out a low laugh. "I thought I told you to go home." Selena drew the sword from her belt. If only she had a blade like Ansel's, not some bit of scrap metal. She shook her hands as she realized who, exactly, stood between her and the master. Not some nameless soldier, not some stranger, or a person she'd been hired to kill, but Ansel. "Why?" Selena whispered. Ansel cocked her head, raising her sword a bit higher. "Why?" Selena had never seen anything more hideous than the hate that twisted Ansel's face. "Because Lord Beric promised me 1,000 men to march into the Flatlands, that's why. Stealing those horses was exactly the public excuse he needed to attack this fortress. And all I had to do was take care of the guards and leave the gate open last night. And bring him this." She gestured with her sword to the master behind her. The master's head. She ran an eye up and down Selena's body, and Selena hated herself for trembling further. "Put down your sword, Selena." Selena didn't move. "Go to hell." Ansel chuckled. "I've been to hell. I spent some time there when I was 12, remember? And when I march into the Flatlands with Beric's troops, I'll see to it that High Lord Locke sees a bit of hell, too. But first..." She turned to the master, and Selena sucked in a breath. "Don't," Selena said. From the distance, Ansel would kill him before she could do anything to stop her. "Just look the other way, Selena." Ansel stepped closer to the man. "If you touch him, I'll put the sword through your neck," Selena snarled. The words shook, and she blinked away the building moisture in her eyes. Ansel looked over her shoulder. "I don't think you will." Ansel took another step closer to the master, and Selena's second dagger flew. It grazed the side of Ansel's armor, leaving a long mark before it clattered to a stop at the foot of the dais. Ansel paused, giving Selena a faint smile. "You missed." "Don't do it." "Why?" Selena put a hand over her heart, tightly gripping her sword with the other. "Because I know what it feels like." She dared another step. "Because I know how it feels to have that kind of hate, Ansel. I know how it feels. And this isn't the way. This," she said louder, gesturing to the fortress and all the corpses in it. All the soldiers and assassins still fighting. "This is not the way." "Says the assassin," Ansel spat. "I've become an assassin because I had no choice. But you have a choice, Ansel. You've always had a choice. Please don't kill him. Please don't make me kill you, was what she truly meant to say. Ansel shut her eyes. Selena steadied her wrist, testing the balance of her blade, trying to get a sense of its weight. When Ansel opened her eyes, there was little of the girl she'd grown to care for over the past month. These men, Ansel said, her sword rising higher. These men destroy everything. I know. You know, and yet you do nothing. You're just a dog chained to your master. She closed the distance between them, her sword lowering. Selena almost sagged with relief, but didn't lighten her grip on her own blade. Ansel's breathing was ragged. You could come with me. She brushed back a strand of Selena's hair. The two of us alone could conquer the Flatlands, and with Lord Beric's troops? Her hand grazed Selena's cheek, and Selena tried not to recoil at the touch and at the words that came out of Ansel's mouth. I would make you my right hand. We'd take the Flatlands back. I can't, Selena answered, even though she could see Ansel's plan with perfect clarity, even if it was tempting. Ansel stepped back. What does Riftold have that's so special? How long will you bow and scrape for that monster? I can't go with you when you know it, so take your troops and leave, Ansel. She watched the expression flitter across Ansel's face. Hurt, denial, rage. So be it, Ansel said. She struck, and Selena only had time to tilt her head to dodge the hidden dagger that shot out of Ansel's wrist. The blade grazed her cheek, and blood warmed her face. Her face. Ansel swiped with her sword, so close that Selena had to flip herself backward. She landed on her feet, but Ansel was fast and near enough that Selena could only bring up her blade. Their swords met. Selena spun, shoving Ansel's sword from hers. Ansel stumbled, and Selena used the moment to gain the advantage, striking again and again. Ansel's superior blade was hardly impacted. They passed the prostrate master and the dais. Selena dropped to the ground, swiping at Ansel with a leg. Ansel leapt back, dodging the blow. Selena used the precious seconds to snatch her fallen dagger from where it lay on the dais steps. When Ansel struck again, she met the cross blades of Selena's sword and dagger. Ansel let out a low laugh. How do you imagine this ending? She pressed Selena's blades. Or is it a fight to the death? Selena braced her feet against the floor. She'd never known Ansel was so strong, or so much taller than her. And Ansel's armor, how would she get through that? There was a joint between the armpit and the ribs, and then around her neck. You tell me, Selena said. The blood from her cheeks slid down her throat. You seem to have everything planned. I tried to protect you. Ansel shoved hard against Selena's blades, but not strongly enough to dislodge them. And you came back anyway. You call that protection? Drugging me and leaving me in the desert? Selena bared her teeth. Before she could launch another assault, Ansel struck with her free hand, right across the X made by their weapons, her fist slamming between Selena's eyes. Selena's head snapped back, the world flashing, and she landed hard on her knees. Her sword and dagger clattered to the floor. Ansel was on her in a second, her bloodied arm across Selena's chest, the other hand pressing the edge of her sword against Selena's unmarred cheek. Give me one reason not to kill you right here, Ansel whispered into her ear, kicking away Selena's sword. Her fallen dagger still lay near them, just out of reach. Selena struggled, trying to put some distance between Ansel's sword and her face. Oh, how vain can you be? Ansel said. And Selena winced as the sword dug into her skin. Afraid I'll scar your face? Ansel angled the sword downward, the blade now biting into Selena's throat. What about your neck? Stop it! I didn't want it to end this way between us. I didn't want you to be part of this. Selena believed her. If Ansel wanted to kill her, she would have done it already. If she wanted to kill the master, she would have done that too already. And all of this waffling between sadistic hate and passion and regret. You're insane, Selena said. Ansel snorted. Who killed Mikhail? Selena demanded. Anything to keep her talking, to keep her focused on herself, because just a few feet away lay her dagger. I did, Ansel said. A little of the fierceness faded from her voice. Her back pressed against Ansel's chest. Selena couldn't be sure without seeing Ansel's face, but she could have sworn that the words were tinged with remorse. When Beric's men attacked, I made sure that I was the one who notified the master. The fool didn't sniff once at the water jug he drank from before he went to the gates. But then Mikhail figured out what I was doing and burst in here. Too late to stop the master from drinking, though. And then Ilias just got in the way. Slaena looked at Ilias, who still lay on the ground, still breathing. The master watched his son, his eyes wide and pleading. If someone didn't staunch Ilias's bleeding, he'd die soon. The master's fingers twitched slightly, making a curving motion. How many others did you kill? Slaena asked, trying to keep Anson distracted as the master made the motion again, a kind of slow, strange wriggling. Only them, and the three on the night watch. I let the soldiers do the rest. The master's finger twisted and slithered. Like a snake. One strike. That was all it would take. Just like the asp. Ansel was fast. Slaena had to be faster. You know what, Ansel? Slaena breathed, memorizing the motions she'd have to make in the next few seconds. Imagining her muscles moving, praying not to falter, to stay focused. Ansel pressed the edge of the blade into Selena's throat. What, Slaena? You want to know what the master taught me during all those lessons? She felt Ansel tense, felt the question distract her. It was all the opportunity she needed. This. Slaena twisted, slamming her shoulder into Ansel's torso, her bones connected against the armor with a jarring thud, and the sword cut into Selena's neck. But Ansel lost her balance and teetered back. Slaena hit Ansel's fingers so hard they dropped the sword right into Selena's awaiting hand. In a flash, like a snake turning in on itself, Slaena pinned Ansel face down on the ground, her father's sword now pressed against the back of her neck. Slaena hadn't realized how silent the room was until she was kneeling there, one knee holding Ansel to the ground, the other braced on the floor. Blood seeped from where the sword tip rested against Ansel's tan neck, redder than her hair. "Don't do it," Ansel whispered, in that voice that she'd so often heard, that girlish, carefree voice. But had it always been a performance? Slaena pushed harder, and Ansel sucked in a breath, closing her eyes. Slaena tightened her grip on the sword, willing steel into her veins. Ansel should die for what she'd done. She deserved to die. And not just for all those assassins lying dead around them, but also for the soldiers who'd spent their lives for her agenda. And for Slaena herself, who even as she knelt there, felt her heart breaking. Even if she didn't put the sword through Ansel's neck, she'd still lose her. She already lost her. But maybe the world had lost Ansel long before today. Slaena couldn't stop her lips from trembling as she asked, "Was it ever real?" Ansel opened an eye, staring at the far wall. "There were some moments when it was. The moment I sent you away, it was real." Slaena reined in her sob and took a long, steadying breath. Slowly, she lifted the sword from Ansel's neck, only a fraction of an inch. Ansel made to move, but Slaena pressed the steel against her skin again, and she went still. From outside came cries of victory, and concern, in voices that sounded hoarse from disuse. The assassins had won. How long before they got here? If they saw Ansel, what she had done, they'd kill her. "You have 5 minutes to pack your things and leave the fortress," Slaena said quietly. "Because in 20 minutes, I'm going up to the battlements and I'm going to fire an arrow at you, and you'd better hope that you're out of range by then, because if you're not, that arrow is going straight through your neck." Slaena lifted the sword. Ansel slowly got to her feet, but didn't flee. It took Slaena a heartbeat to realize she was waiting for her father's sword. Slaena looked at the wolf-shaped hilt and the blood staining the steel, the one tie Ansel had left to her father, her family, and whatever twisted shred of hope burned in her heart. Slaena turned the blade and handed it hilt first to Ansel. The girl's eyes were damp as she took the sword. She opened her mouth, but Slaena cut her off. "Go home, Ansel." Ansel's face went white again. She sheathed the sword at her side. She glanced at Slaena only once before she took off at a sprint, leaping over Mikhail's corpse as if he were nothing more than a bit of debris. Then she was gone. And that was chapter 11. But I just realized you can see Mira laying on the box in the corner of stream.
She wants to be on stream.
Oh my goodness.
She's going off for stream.
Which is weird because normally she lays on her little tower over here.
She wants to be on stream.
Okay, well, you guys are getting a free Mira cam currently.
She came over and said hi and then got on the box. And is looking at me like I'm supposed to go over there and pet her. but I don't want to be on the street.
You're too cute, Lyra.
Too cute. Okay. Oh. Thank you, Lilith, for the cat ears. And as always, the cat ears during reading streams will remain on for one chapter, or however long until I remember to take them off. Because, you know, I am not very good at, you know, actually remembering to put them on or off. Anyways. On. It's chapter 12. Selena rushed to Ilias, who moaned as she turned him over. The wound in his stomach was still bleeding. She ripped strips from her tunic, which was already soaked with blood, and shouted for help as she bound him tightly. There was a scrape of cloth on stone, and Selena looked over her shoulder to see the master trying to drag himself across the stones to his son. The paralytic must be wearing off. 5 bloodied assassins came rushing up the stairs, eyes wide and faces pale as they beheld Mikhail and Ilias. Selena left Ilias in their care as she dashed to the master. "Don't move," she told him, wincing as blood from her face dripped onto his white clothes. "You might hurt yourself." She scanned the podium for any sign of the poison and rushed to the fallen bronze goblet. A few sniffs revealed that the wine had been laced with a small amount of Gloriella, just enough to paralyze him, not kill him. Ansel must have wanted him completely prone before she killed him, must have wanted him to know she was the one who had betrayed him, to have him conscious while she severed his head. How had he not noticed it before he drank? Perhaps he wasn't as humble as he seemed. Perhaps he'd been arrogant enough to believe that he was safe here. "It'll wear off soon," she told the master. But she still called for an antidote to speed up the process. One of the assassins took off at a run. She sat by the master, one hand clutching her bleeding neck. The assassins at the other end of the room carried Ilias out, stopping to reassure the master that his son would be fine. Selena nearly groaned with relief at that, but straightened as a dry, calloused hand wrapped around hers, squeezing faintly. She looked down into the face of the master, whose eyes shifted to the open door. He was reminding her of the promise she'd made. Ansel had been given 20 minutes to clear firing range. It was time. Ansel was already a dark blur in the distance, hissily galloping as if demons were biting at her hooves. She was heading northwest over the dunes, toward the Singing Sands, to the narrow bridge of feral jungle that separated the deserted land from the rest of the continent, and then the open expanse of the western wastes beyond them, toward Briarcliff. Atop the battlements, Selena drew an arrow from her quiver and knocked it into her bow. The bowstring moaned as she pulled it back, farther and farther, her arm straining. Focusing upon the tiny figure atop the dark horse, Selena took aim. In the silence of the fortress, the bowstring twanged like a mournful harp. The arrow soared, turning relentlessly. The red dunes passed beneath in a blur, closing the distance. A sliver of winged darkness edged with steel. A quick, bloody death. Hisley's tail flicked to the side as the arrow buried itself in the sand, just inches behind her rear hooves. But Ansel didn't dare look over her shoulder. She kept riding, and she did not stop. Selena lowered her bow and watched until Ansel disappeared beyond the horizon. One arrow, that had been her promise. But she'd also promised Ansel that she had 20 minutes to get out of range. Selena had fired after 21. The master called Selena to his chamber the following morning. It had been a long night, but Ilias was on the mend, and the wound having narrowly missed puncturing any organs. All of Lord Beric's soldiers were dead and were in the process of being carted back to Xandria as a reminder to Beric to seek the King of Adderland's approval elsewhere. 20 assassins had died, and a heavy, mourning silence filled the fortress. Selena sat on an ornately carved wooden chair, watching the master as he stared out the window at the sky. She nearly fell out of her seat when he began speaking. "I am glad you did not kill Ansel." His voice was raw, and his accent thick with the clipped yet rolling sounds of some language she'd never heard before. "I have been wondering when she would decide what to do with her fate." "So you knew?" The master turned from the window. "I have known for years. Several months after Ansel's arrival, I sent inquiries to the Flatlands. Her family had not written her any letters, and I was worried that something might have happened." He took a seat in a chair across from Selena. "My messenger returned to me some months later, saying that there was no Briarcliff. The lord and his eldest daughter had been murdered by the High King, and the youngest daughter, Ansel, was missing." Why didn't you ever confront her? Selena touched the narrow scab on her left cheek. It would scar if she looked at... It wouldn't scar if she looked after it properly. And if it did scar, then maybe she'd hunt down Ansel and return the favor. Because I hoped she would eventually trust me enough to tell me. I had to give her the chance, even though it was a risk. I hoped she would learn to face her pain. That she'd learn to endure it. He smiled sadly at Selena. If you can learn to endure pain, you can survive anything. Some people learn to embrace it, to love it. Some endure it through drowning in it in sorrow, or by making themselves forget. Others turn it into anger. But Ansel let her pain become hate, and let it consume her until she became something else entirely, a person I don't think she ever wished to be. Selena absorbed his words, but set them aside for consideration at a later time. Are you going to tell everyone about what she did? No, I would spare them that anger. Many believe Ansel was their friend, and part of me, too, believes that at times she was. Selena looked at the floor, wondering what to do with the ache in her chest. Would turning it into rage, as he said, help her endure it? For what it's worth, Selena, he rasped, I believe you were the closest thing to a friend Ansel has ever allowed herself to have. And I think she sent you away because she truly cared for you. She hated her mouth for wobbling. That doesn't make it hurt any less. I didn't think that it would. But I think you will leave a lasting imprint on Ansel's heart. You spared her life and returned her father's sword. She will not soon forget that. And maybe when she makes her next move to reclaim her title, she will remember the assassin from the north and the kindness you showed her, and try to leave fewer bodies in her wake. He walked to a latticework hutch, as if he were giving her the time to regain her composure, and pulled out a letter. By the time he returned to her, Selena's eyes were clear. When you give this to your master, hold your head high. She took the letter, her recommendation. It seemed inconsequential in the face of everything that had just happened. How is it that you're speaking to me now? I thought your vow of silence was eternal. He shrugged. The world seems to think so, but as far as my memory serves me, I have never officially sworn to be silent. I choose to be silent most of the time, and I've become so used to it that I often forget that I have the capacity for speech. But there are some times when words are necessary, when explanations are needed that mere gestures cannot convey. She nodded, trying her best to hide her surprise. After a pause, the master said, If you ever want to leave the north, you will always have a home here. I promise you the winter months are far better than the summer, and I think my son would be rather happy if you decided to return, too. He chuckled, and Selena blushed. He took her hand. When you leave tomorrow, you'll be accompanied by a few of my people. Why? Because they will be needed to drive the wagon to Xandria. I know that you are indentured to your master. That you still owe him a good deal of money before you are free to live your own life. He's making you pay back a fortune that he forced you to borrow. He squeezed her hand before approaching one of the three trunks pushed against the wall. For saving my life and sparing hers. He flipped open the lid of a trunk, then another, and another. Sunlight gleamed on the gold inside, reflecting through the room like light on water. All that gold, and the piece of spider silk that the merchant had given her. She couldn't think of the possibilities that wealth would open to her. Not right now. When you give your master his letter, also give him this, and tell him that in the Red Desert, we do not abuse our disciples. Selena smiled slowly. I think I can manage that. She looked to the open window, to the world beyond. For the first time in a long while, she heard the song of a northern wind calling her home, and she was not afraid. And that is the end of The Assassin in the Desert. We will be starting The Assassin and the Underworld next. No, they had dinner. Attention, probably?
She won't jump up.
I don't know, it might be too hot for her to cuddle. Okay. The Assassin in the Underworld, Chapter 1. The cavernous entrance hall of the Assassin's Keep was silent as Selena Sardothian stalked across the marble floor, a letter clutched between her fingers. No one had greeted her at the towering oak door save the housekeeper, who'd taken her rain-sodden cloak, and after getting a look at the wicked grin on Selena's face, opted not to say anything. The doors to Arabin Hamel's study lay at the other end of the hall, and were currently shut, but she knew he was in there. Wesley, his bodyguard, stood watch outside, dark eyes unreadable as Selena strode toward him. Though Wesley wasn't officially an assassin, she had no doubt that he could wield the blades and daggers strapped to his massive body with deadly skill. She also had no doubt that Arabin had eyes at every gate in the city. The moment she'd stepped into Riphold, he'd been alerted that she'd at last returned. She trailed mud from her wet, filthy boots as she made her way toward the study doors. And Wesley. It had been 3 months since the night Arabin had beaten her unconscious, punishment for ruining his slave trade agreement with the pirate lord, Captain Rolf. It had been 3 months since he'd shipped her off to the Red Desert to learn obedience and discipline, and to earn the approval of the mute master of the Silent Assassins. The letter clutched in her hand was proof that she had done it, proof that Arabin hadn't broken her that night, and she couldn't wait to see the look on his face when she gave it to him. Not to mention when she told him about the 3 trunks of gold she'd brought with her, which were on their way up to her room at this moment. With a few words, she'd explained that her debt to him was now repaid, that she was going to walk out of the keep and move into the new apartment she'd purchased, that she was free of him. Selena reached the other end of the hall, and Wesley stepped in front of the study doors. He looked about 5 years younger than Arabin, and the slender scars on his face and hands suggested that the life he'd spent serving the King of Assassins hadn't been easy. She suspected there were more scars beneath his dark clothing, perhaps brutal ones. "He's busy," Wesley said, his hands hanging loosely at his sides, ready to reach for his weapons. She might be Arabin's protege, but Wesley had always made it clear that if she became a threat to his master, he wouldn't hesitate to end her. She didn't need to see him in action to know he'd be an interesting opponent. She supposed that was why he did his training in private, and kept his personal history a secret too. The less she knew about him, the more advantage Wesley would have if that fight ever came. Clever and flattering, she supposed. "Nice to see you too, Wesley," she said, flashing him a smile. He tensed, but didn't stop her as she strode past him and flung open the doors of Arabin's study. The King of the Assassins was seated at his ornate desk, poring over the stack of papers before him. Without so much as a hello, Selena strode right up to the desk and tossed the letter onto the shining wooden surface. She opened her mouth, the words near bursting out of her, but Arabin merely lifted a finger, smiling faintly, and returned to his papers. Wesley shut the doors behind her. Selena froze. Arabin flipped the page, rapidly scanning whatever document was in front of him, and made a vague wave of it with his hand. "Sit." With his attention still on the document he was reading, Arabin picked up the mute master's letter of approval and set it atop a nearby stack of papers. Selena blinked. Once. Twice. He didn't look up at her. He just kept reading. The message was clear enough. She was to wait until he was ready. And until then, even if she screamed until her lungs burst, he wouldn't acknowledge her existence. So Selena sat down. Rain plinked against the windows of the study. Seconds passed, then minutes. Her plans for a grand speech with sweeping gestures faded into silence. Arabin read 3 other documents before he even picked up the mute master's letter. And as he read it, she could only think of the last time she'd sat in this chair. She looked at the exquisite red carpet beneath her feet. Someone had done a splendid job of getting all the blood out. How much of the blood on the carpet had been hers, and how much of it had belonged to Sam Cortland, her rival and conspirator in the destruction of Arabin's slave agreement. She still didn't know what Arabin had done to him that night. When she'd arrived just now, she hadn't seen Sam in the entrance hall. But then again, she hadn't seen any of the other assassins who lived here. So maybe Sam was busy. She hoped he was busy, because that would mean he was alive. Arabin finally looked at her, setting aside the mute master's letter, as if it were nothing more than a scrap of paper. She kept her back straight and her chin upheld, even as Arabin's silver eyes scanned every inch of her. They lingered the longest on the narrow pink scar across the side of her neck, inches away from her jaw and ear. "Well," Arabin said at last, "I thought you'd be Tanner." She almost laughed, but she kept a tight rein on her features. "Had to close to avoid the sun," she explained. Her words were quieter, weaker than she wanted. The first words she'd spoken to him since he'd beaten her into oblivion. They weren't exactly satisfying. Ah, he said, his long, elegant fingers twisting a golden ring around his forefinger. She sucked in a breath through her nose, remembering all that she'd been burning to say to him these past few months, and during the journey back to Rifthold. A few sentences, and it would be over. More than 8 years with him, finished with a string of words and a mountain of gold. She braced herself to begin, but Arabin spoke first. I'm sorry, he said. Yet again, the words vanished from her lips. His eyes were intent on hers, and he stopped toying with his ring. If I could take back that night, Selena, I would. He leaned over the edge of the desk, his hands now forming fists. The last time she'd seen those hands, they'd been smeared with her blood. I'm sorry, Arabin repeated. He was nearly 20 years her senior, and though his red hair had a few strands of silver, his face remained young. Elegant, sharp features, blazingly clear gray eyes. He might not have been the handsomest man she'd ever seen, but he was one of the most alluring. Every day, he went on, every day since you left, I've gone to the Temple of Kiva to pray for forgiveness. She might have snorted at the idea of the King of the Assassins kneeling before a statue of the God of Atonement, but his words were so raw. Was it possible that he actually regretted what he had done? I shouldn't have let my temper get the better of me. I shouldn't have sent you away. And why didn't you retrieve me? It was out before she had a chance to control the snap in her voice. Arabin's eyes narrowed slightly, as close to a wince as he'd let himself come, she supposed. With the time it'd take for the messengers to track you down, you probably would have been on your way home anyway. She clenched her jaw, an easy excuse. He read the ire in her eyes, and her disbelief. Allow me to make it up to you. He rose from his leather chair and strode around the desk. His long legs and years of training made his movements effortlessly graceful, even as he swiped a box off the edge of the table. He sank to one knee before her, his face near level with hers. She'd forgotten how tall he was. He extended the gift to her. The box in itself was a work of art, inlaid with mother of pearl, but she kept her face blank as she flipped open the lid. An emerald and gold brooch glittered in the gray afternoon light. It was stunning, the work of a master craftsman, and she instantly knew what dresses and tunics it would best complement. He'd bought it because he also knew her wardrobe, her tastes, everything about her. Of all the people in the world, only Arabin knew the absolute truth. For you, he said, the first of many. She was keenly aware of each of his movements, and braced herself as he lifted a hand, carefully bringing it to her face. He brushed a finger from her temple down to the arc of her cheekbones. I'm sorry, he whispered again, and Selena raised her eyes to his. Father, brother, lover, he'd never really declared himself any of them. Certainly not the lover part. Though if Selena had been another sort of girl, and if Arabin had raised her differently, perhaps it might have come to that. He loved her like family, yet he put her in the most dangerous positions. He nurtured and educated her, yet he'd obliterated her innocence the first time he'd made her end a life. He'd given her everything, but he'd also taken away everything. She could no sooner sort out her feelings toward the King of Assassins than she could count the stars in the sky. Selena turned her face away, and Arabin rose to his feet. He leaned against the edge of the desk, smiling faintly at her. I've another gift if you'd like it. All those months of daydreaming about leaving, about paying off her debts. Why couldn't she open her mouth and just tell him? Benzo Donoval is coming to Rifthold, Arabin said. Selena cocked her head. She'd heard of Donoval. He was an immensely powerful businessman from Melisande, a country far to the southwest, and one of Adderland's newer conquests. Why? She asked quietly. Carefully. Arabin's eyes glittered. He's a part of a large convoy that Lifer Bardingale is leading to the capital. Lifer is good friends with the former Queen of Melisande, who asked her to come here to plead their case before the King of Adderland. Melisande, Selena recalled, was one of the few kingdoms whose royal family had not been executed. Instead, they'd handed over their crowns and sword, loyalty to the King of Adderlin and his conquering legions. She couldn't tell what was worse, a quick beheading or yielding to the king. Apparently, Arabin went on, the convoy will attempt to demonstrate all that Melisande has to offer, culture, goods, wealth, in order to convince the king to grant them the permission and resources required to build a road. Given that the young Queen of Melisande is now a mere figurehead, I'll admit that I'm impressed by her ambition, and her brazenness in asking the king. Selena bit her lip, visualizing the map of their continent. A road to connect Melisande to Fenharrow and Otterlin? For years, trade with Melisande had been tricky due to its location. bordered by near impassable mountains and the Oakwald Forest, most of their trade had been reduced to whatever they could get out of their ports. A road might change all of that. A road could make Melisande rich and influential. Arabin nodded. The convoy will be here for a week, and they have parties and markets planned, including a gala 3 days from now to celebrate the Harvest Moon. Perhaps if the citizens of Rifthold fall in love with their goods, then the king will take their case seriously. So what does Donegal have to do with the road? Arabin shrugged. He's here to discuss business arrangements in Rifthold, and probably also to undermine his former wife, Leifer, and to complete one very specific piece of business that made Leifer want to dispatch him. Slater's brows rose. A gift, Arabin had said. Donegal is traveling with some very sensitive documents, Arabin said so quietly that the rain lashing the window nearly drowned out his words. Not only would you need to dispatch him, but you'd also be asked to retrieve the documents. What sort of documents? His silver eyes brightened. Donegal wants to set up a slave trade business between himself and someone in Rifthold. If the road is approved and built, he wants to be the first in Melisande to profit off the import and export of slaves. The documents, apparently, contain proof that certain influential Melisanders and Adderlin are opposed to the slave trade. Considering the lengths the King of Adderlin has already gone to punish those who speak against his policies. Well, knowing who stands against him regarding the slaves, especially when it seems like they're taking steps to help free the slaves from his grasp, is information the king would be extremely interested in learning. Donegal and his new business partner in Rifthold plan to use that list to blackmail those people into changing their minds, into stopping their resistance and investing with him to build the slave trade in Melisande. Or if they refuse, Leifer believes her former husband will make sure the king gets that list of names. Slaena swallowed hard. Was this a peace offering, then? Some indication that Arabin had actually changed his mind about the slave trade and forgiven her for Skull's Bay? But to get tangled up in this sort of thing again. What is Bardingale's stake in this? She asked carefully. Why hire us to kill him? Because Leifer doesn't believe in slavery. And she wants to protect the people on that list. People who are preparing to take the necessary steps to soften the blow of slavery in Melisande. And possibly even smuggle captured slaves to safety. Arabin spoke like he knew Bardingale personally. Like they were more than business partners. And Donegal's partner in Rifthold, who is it? She had to consider all the angles before she accepted. Had to think it through. Leifer doesn't know. Her sources haven't been able to find a name in Donegal's coded correspondences with his partner. All she's gleaned is that Donegal will exchange the documents with his new business partner 6 days from now at his rented house, at some point in the day. She's uncertain what documents his partner is bringing to the table, but she's betting that it includes a list of important people opposed to slavery in Adderlin. Leifer says Donegal will probably have a private room in his house to do the swap, perhaps an upstairs study or something of the sort. She knows him well enough to guarantee that. She was beginning to see where this was going. Donegal was practically wrapped in a ribbon for her. All she had to do was find out what time the meeting would take place, learn his defenses, and figure out a way around them. So I'm not only to take out Donegal, but also to wait until he's done the exchange, so I can get his documents and whatever documents his partner brings to the table? Arabin smiled slightly. What about his partner? Am I to dispatch this person as well? Arabin's smile became a thin line. Since we don't know who he'll be dealing with, you haven't been contracted to eliminate them. But it's been strongly hinted that Leifer will be, and her allies, want the contact dead as well. They might give you a bonus for it. She studied the emerald brooch in her lap. And how well would this pay? Extraordinarily well. She heard the smile in his voice, but kept her attention on the lovely green jewel. And I won't take a cut of it. It's all yours. She raised her head at that. There was a glimmer of pleading in his eyes. Perhaps he truly was sorry for what he'd done. And perhaps he'd picked this mission just for her, to prove, in his way, that he understood why she'd freed those slaves in Skull's Bay. I can assume Donegal is well guarded? Very, Arabin said, fishing a letter from the desk behind him. He's waiting to do the deal until after the citywide celebrations, so he can run home the next day. Slaena glanced toward the ceiling, as if she could see through the wood beams and into her room on the floor above, where her trunks of gold now sat. She didn't need the money, but if she were going to pay off her debt to Arabin, her funds would be severely depleted. And to take this mission wouldn't just be about killing. It would be about helping others, too. How many lives would be destroyed if she didn't dispatch Donoval and his partner and retrieve those sensitive documents? Arabin approached her again, and she rose from her chair. He brushed her hair back from her face. "I missed you," he said. He opened his arms to her, but didn't make a further move to embrace her. She studied his face. The Mute Master had told her that people dealt with their pain in different ways, that some chose to drown it, some chose to love it, and some chose to let it turn into rage. Though she had no regrets about freeing those 200 slaves from Skull's Bay, she had betrayed Arabin in doing it. Perhaps hurting her had been his way of coping with the pain of that. And even though there was no excuse in this world for what he had done, Arabin was all she had. The history that lay between them, dark and twisted and full of secrets, was forged by more than just gold. And if she left him, if she paid off her debts right now and never saw him again... She took a step back, and Arabin casually lowered his arms, not at all fazed by her rejection. "I'll think about taking on Donoval." It wasn't a lie. She always took time to consider her missions. Arabin had encouraged that from the start. "I'm sorry," he said again. Slaina gave him another long look before she left. Her exhaustion hit her the moment she began climbing the polished marble steps of the sweeping grand staircase. A month of hard travel, a month after a month of grueling training and heartache. Every time she saw the scar on her neck, or touched it, or felt her clothes brush against it, a tremor of pain went through her as she remembered the betrayal that had caused it. She believed Ansel was her friend, a life friend, a friend of the heart. But Ansel's need for revenge had been greater than anything else. Still, wherever Ansel now was, Slaina hoped that she was finally facing what had haunted her for so long. A passing servant bowed his head, eyes averted. Everyone who worked here knew more or less who she was, and would keep her identity a secret, on pain of death. Not that there was much of a point to it now, given that every single one of the silent assassins could identify her. Slaina took a ragged breath, running a hand through her hair. Before entering the city this morning, she'd stopped at a tavern just outside Rifthold to bathe, to wash her filthy clothes, to put on some cosmetics. She hadn't wanted to stride into the keep looking like a gutter rat, but she still felt dirty. She passed one of the upstairs drawing rooms, her brows rising at the sound of a pianoforte and laughing people inside. If Arabin had company, then why had he been in his study, ever so busy, when she arrived? Slaina ground her teeth. So that nonsense where he'd made her wait while he finished his work? She clenched her hands into fists and was about to whirl and stomp back down the stairs to tell Arabin that she was leaving and that he no longer owned her, when someone stepped into the elegantly appointed hall. Sam Cortland. Sam's brown eyes were wide, his body rigid, as if it took some effort on his part. He shut the door to the hall washroom and strode toward her, past the teal velvet curtains hanging on the floor-to-ceiling windows, past the framed artwork, closer and closer. She remained still, taking in every inch of him before he stopped a few feet away. No missing limbs, no limp, no indication of anything haunting him. His chestnut hair had gotten a little longer, but it suited him, and he was tan, gloriously tan, as if he'd spent the whole summer basking in the sun. Hadn't Arabin punished him at all? "You're back," Sam said, as if he couldn't quite believe it. She lifted her chin, stuffing her hands into her pockets. "Obviously." He tilted his head slightly to the side. "How was the desert?" There wasn't a scratch on him. Of course, her face had healed too. "But... hot," she said. Sam let out a breathy chuckle. It wasn't that she was mad at him for being uninjured. She was so relieved she could have vomited, actually. She just never imagined that seeing him today would feel so... strange. And after what had happened with Ansel, could she honestly say that she trusted him? In the drawing from a few doors down, a woman let out a shrill giggle. How was it possible that she could have so many questions and yet so little to say? Sam's eyes slipped from her face to her neck, his brows drawing together for a heartbeat as he saw the thin new scar. What happened? Someone held a sword to my throat. His eyes darkened, but she didn't want to explain the long, miserable story. She didn't want to talk about Ansel, and she certainly didn't want to talk about what happened with Arabin that night they'd returned from Skull's Bay. "Are you hurt?" Sam asked quietly, taking another step closer. It took her a moment to realize that his imagination had probably taken him to a far, far worse place when she said someone had held a blade to her throat. "No," she said. "No, not like that." "Then like what?" He was now looking more closely at her, of the almost invisible white line along her cheek. Another gift from Ansel. At her hands, at everything. His lean, muscled body tensed. His chest had gotten broader, too. Like none of your business, that's what, she retorted. Tell me what happened, he gritted out. She gave him one of those simpering little smiles that she knew he hated. Things hadn't been bad between them since Skull's Bay, but after so many years of treating him awfully, she didn't know how to slide back into that newfound respect and camaraderie they'd discovered for each other. Why should I tell you anything? Because, he hissed, taking another step, the last time I saw you, Selena, you were unconscious on Arabin's carpet and so bloodied up that I couldn't see your damn face. He was close enough that she could touch him now. Rain continued beating against the hall windows, a distant reminder that there was still a world around them. Tell me, he said. I'll kill you, Sam had screamed it at Arabin as the King of the Assassins beat her. He roared it. In those horrible minutes, whatever bond had sprung up between her and Sam hadn't broken. He'd switched loyalties. He'd chosen to stand by her, fight for her. If anything, that made him different from Ansel. Sam could have hurt or betrayed her a dozen times over, but he'd never jumped at the opportunity. A half-smile tugged at the corner of her lips. She missed him. Seeing the expression on her face, he gave her a bewildered sort of grin. She swallowed, feeling the words bubbling up through her. I missed you. But the door to the drawing room opened. Sam! A dark, green-eyed young woman chided, laughter on her lips. There you! The girl's eyes met Selena's. Selena stopped smiling as she recognized her. A feline sort of smirk spread across the young woman's stunning features, and she slipped out of the doorway and slunk over to them. Selena took in each swish of her hips, the elegant angle of her hand, the exquisite dress that dipped low enough to reveal her generous bosom. Selena! She cooed, and Sam eyed the two girls warily as she stopped beside him, too close beside him for a casual acquaintance. Lysandra! Selena echoed. She'd met Lysandra when they were both 10, and in the 7 years that they'd known each other, Selena couldn't recall a time when she didn't want to beat in the girl's face with a brick, or throw her out a window, or do any of a number of things she'd learned from Arabin. It didn't help that Arabin had spent a good deal of money on assisting Lysandra in her rise from street orphan to one of the most anticipated courtesans in Rifthold's history. He was good friends with Lysandra's madam, and had been Lysandra's doting benefactor for years. Lysandra and her madam remained the only courtesans aware that the girl Arabin called his niece was actually his protege. Selena had never learned why Arabin had told them. But whenever she complained about the risk of Lysandra revealing her identity, he seemed certain she would not. Selena, not surprisingly, had trouble believing it. But perhaps threats from the King of Assassins were enough to keep even the loud-mouthed Lysandra silent. I thought you'd been packed off to the desert, Lysandra said, running a shrewd eye over Selena's clothes. Think the word she'd bothered to change at that tavern. Is it possible the summer had passed that quickly? I guess when you're having so much fun. A deadly vicious sort of calm filled Selena's veins. She'd snapped once at Lysandra when they were 13, and Lysandra had snatched a lovely lace fan right out of Selena's hands. The ensuing fight had sent them tumbling down a flight of stairs. Selena had spent a night in the keep's dungeons for the welts she'd left on Lysandra's face by beating her with the fan itself. She tried to ignore how close the girl stood to Sam. He'd always been kind to the courtesans, and they all adored him. His mother had been one of them, and had asked Arabin, a patron of hers, to look after her son. Sam had only been 6 when she was murdered by a jealous client. Selena crossed her arms. Should I bother to ask what you're doing here? Lysandra gave her a knowing smile. Oh, Arabin! She purred his name like they were the most intimate of friends. Threw me a luncheon in order of my upcoming bidding. Of course he did. He invited your future clients here? Oh no, Lysandra giggled. This is just for me and the girls. And Clarice, of course. She used her madam's name too, like a weapon. A word meant to crush and dominate. A word that whispered, I am more important than you. I have more influence than you. I am everything and you are nothing. Lovely, Selena replied. Sam still hadn't said anything. Lysandra lifted her chin, looking down her delicately freckled nose at Selena. My bidding is in 6 days. They expect me to break all the records. Selena had seen a few young courtesans go through the bidding process, girls trained until they were 17, when their virginity was sold to the highest bidder. Sam, Lysandra went on, putting a slender hand on his arm, has been so helpful with making sure all the preparations are ready for my bidding party. Selena was surprised at the swiftness of her desire to rip that hand right off Lysandra's wrist. Just because he sympathized with the courtesans didn't mean that he had to be so friendly with them. Sam cleared his throat, straightening. Not that helpful. Arabin wanted to make sure that the vendors and location were secure. Important clientele must be given the best treatment, Lysandra trilled. I do wish I could tell you who will be in attendance, but Clarice would kill me. It's extraordinarily hush-hush and need to know. It was enough. One more word out of the courtesan's mouth, and Selena was fairly certain she'd punch Lysandra's teeth down her throat. Selena angled her head, her fingers curling into a fist. Sam saw the familiar gesture and pried Lysandra's hand off his arm. Go back to the luncheon, he told her. Lysandra gave Selena another one of those smiles, which she then turned on Sam. When are you coming back in? Her full, red lips formed a pout. Enough. 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 Selena turned on her heel. Enjoy your quality company, she said over her shoulder. Selena, Sam said. But she wouldn't turn around, not even when she heard Lysandra giggle and whisper something. Not even when all she wanted in the entire world was to grab her dagger and throw, as hard as she could, right toward Lysandra's impossibly beautiful face. She'd always hated Lysandra, she told herself. Always hated her. Her touching Sam like that, speaking to Sam like that, it didn't change things. But, though Lysandra's virginity was unquestionable, it had to be. There were plenty of other things that she could still do. Things that she might have done with Sam. Feeling sick and furious and small, Selena reached her bedroom and slammed the door hard enough to rattle the rain-splattered windows. And that was chapter one. Oh. That chapter was really long. I'm not even gonna lie. Getting slightly lightheaded at the end of there. That chapter in and of itself was almost half an hour long. Oh, and just for future reference, I'm going to put in chat right now how you spell Selena's name. In case you guys ever want to, like, Google anything about the book, it is spelt like this. There you go. That is how to spell it. Like I said, in case you guys ever want to look up any fan art or anything like that. Anyways. Whew. On to chapter two. The rain didn't stop the next day, and Selena awoke to a grumble of thunder and a servant setting a long, beautifully wrapped box on her dresser. She opened the gift as she drank her morning cup of tea, taking her time with a turquoise ribbon, doing her best to pretend that she wasn't that interested in what Arabin had sent her. None of these presents came close to earning any sort of forgiveness. She couldn't contain her squeal when she opened the box and found two golden hair combs glinting at her. They were exquisite, formed like sharp fish fins, each point accentuated with a silver sapphire. She nearly upset her breakfast tray as she rushed from the table by the window to the rosewood vanity. With deft hands, she dragged one of the combs through her hair, sweeping it back before she nimbly flipped it into place. She quickly repeated it on the other side of her head, and when she had finished, she beamed at her reflection, exotic, beguiling, imperious. Arabin might be a bastard, and he might associate with Lysandra, but he had a damn good taste. Oh, it was so nice to be back in civilization, with her beautiful clothes and shoes and jewels and cosmetics and all the luxuries she'd had to spend the summer without. Selena examined the ends of her hair and frowned. The frown deepened when her attention shifted to her hands, to her shredded cuticles and jagged nails. She let out a low hiss, facing the windows along one wall of her ornate bedroom. It was early autumn. That meant rain usually hung around Rifthold for a good couple of weeks. Through the low-hanging clouds and the slashing rain, she could see the rest of the capital city gleaming in the gray light. Pale stone houses stood tucked together, linked by broad avenues that stretched from the alabaster walls to the docks along the eastern quarter of the city, from the teeming city center to the jumble of crumbling buildings in the slums at the southern edge, where the Avery River curved inland. Even the emerald roofs on each building seemed cast in silver. The glass castle towered over them all, its upper turrets shrouded in mist. The convoy from Melisande couldn't have picked a worse time to visit. If they wanted to have street festivals, they'd find few participants willing to brave the merciless downpour. Selena slowly removed the combs from her hair. The convoy would arrive today. Arabin had told her last night over a private dinner. She still hadn't given him an answer about whether she'd take down Donoval in 5 days. And he hadn't pushed her about it. He had been kind and gracious, serving her food himself, speaking softly to her like she was some frightened pet. She glanced again at her hair and nails, a very unkempt, wild-looking pet. She strode to her dressing room. She'd decide what to do about Donoval and his agenda later. For now, not even the rain would keep her from a little pampering. The shop she favored for her upkeep was ecstatic to see her, and utterly horrified at the state of her hair, and nails, and her eyebrows. She couldn't have bothered to pluck her eyebrows while she was away. Half a day later, her hair cut and shining, her nails soft and gleaming, Selena braved the sodden city streets. Even with the rain, people found excuses to be out and about as the giant convoy from Melisande arrived. She paused beneath the awning of a flower shop where the owner was standing on the threshold to watch the grand procession. The Melisanders snaked along the broad avenue that stretched from the western gate of the city all the way to the castle doors. There were the usual jugglers and fire eaters whose jobs were made infinitely harder by the confounded rain, the dance girls whose billowing pants were sodden up to the knees, and then the line of very important, very wealthy people who were bundled under cloaks and didn't sit quite as tall as they probably imagined they would. Selena tucked her numbed fingers into her tunic pockets. Brightly painted covered wagons ambled past. Their hatches had all been shut against the weather, and that meant Selena would start back to the keep immediately. Melisande was known for its tinkerers, for clever hands that created clever little devices. Clockwork so fine you could swear it was alive. Musical instruments so clear and lovely, they could shatter your heart. Toys so charming you'd believe magic hadn't vanished from the continent. If the wagons that contained those things were shut, then she had no interest in watching a parade of soaked, miserable people. Crowds were still flocking toward the main avenue, so Selena took to narrow, winding alleys to avoid them. She wondered if Sam was making his way to see the procession, and if Lysandra was with him. So much for Sam's unwavering loyalty. How long had it taken after she'd gone to the desert before he and Lysandra had become dear, dear friends? Things had been better when she relished the thought of gutting him. Apparently, Sam was just as susceptible to a pretty face as Arabin was. She didn't know why she thought he would be different. She scowled and walked faster, her freezing arms crossed over her chest as she hunched her shoulders against the rain. 20 minutes later, she was dripping water all over the marble floor of the keep's entranceway, and 1 minute after that, she was dripping water all over Arabin's study carpet as she told him that she would take on Donoval, his slave trade blackmail documents, and whoever his co-conspirator might be. The next morning, Selena looked down at herself, her mouth caught between a smile and a frown. The neck-to-toe black outfit was all made from the same dark fabric, as thick as leather, but without the sheen. It was like a suit of armor, only skin-tight and made from some strange cloth, not metal. She could feel the weight of her weapons where they were concealed, so neatly that even someone patting her down might think they were merely ribbing. And she swung her arms experimentally. "Careful," the short man in front of her said, eyes wide. "You might take off my head." Behind them, Arabin chuckled from where he leaned against the paneled wall of the training room. She hadn't asked questions when he'd summoned her, then told her to put on the black suit and matching boots that were lined with fleece. When you want to unsheathe the blades, the inventor said, taking a large step back, it is a downward sweep and an extra flick of the wrist. He demonstrated the motion with his own scrawny arms, and Selena echoed it. She grinned as a narrow blade shot out of the concealed flap in her forearm, permanently attached to the suit, like having a short sword welded to her arm. She made the same motion with the other wrist, and the twin blade appeared. Some internal mechanism had to be responsible for it, some brilliant contraption of springs and gears. She gave a few deadly swings in the air in front of her, reveling in the whoosh, whoosh, whoosh of the swords. They were finally made, too. She raised her brows in admiration. How do they go back? Ah, a little more difficult, the inventor said. Wrist angled up and press this little button here. It should trigger the mechanism. There you go. She watched the blade slide back into the suit, then released and returned the blade several times. The deal with Donovan and his partner was in 4 days, just long enough for her to try using the new suit. 4 days was plenty to figure out his house's defenses and learn what time the meeting would take place, especially since she already knew it was occurring in some private study. At last, she looked at Arabin. How much is it? He pushed off the wall. It's a gift. As are the boots. She knocked a toe against the tiled floor, feeling the jagged edges and grooves of the soles. Perfect for climbing. The sheepskin interior would keep her feet at body temperature, the inventor had said, even if she got them utterly soaked. She'd never even heard of a suit like this. It would completely change the way she conducted her missions. Not that she needed the suit to give her an edge, but she was Selena Sardothian, gods be damned, so didn't she deserve the very best equipment? With this suit, no one would question her place as Adderlyn's assassin. Ever. And if they did, word helped them. The inventor asked to take her final measurements, though the ones Arabin had supplied were almost perfect. She lifted her arms out as he did the measuring, asking him bland questions about his trip for Melisande and what he planned to sell here. He was a master tinkerer, he said, and specialized crafting things that were believed to be impossible, like a suit that was both armor and armory, and lightweight enough to wear comfortably. Selena looked over her shoulder at Arabin, who had watched her interrogation with a bemused smile. Are you getting one made? Of course, and Sam too. Only the best for my best. She noticed that he didn't say assassin, but whatever the tinkerer thought about who they were, his face yielded no sign. She couldn't hide her surprise. You never give Sam gifts. Arabin shrugged, picking at his nails. Oh, Sam will be paying for the suit. I can't have my second best completely vulnerable, can I? She hid her shock better this time. A suit like this had to cost a small fortune. Materials aside, just the hours it must have taken the tinkerer to create it. Arabin had to have commissioned them immediately after he'd sent her to the Red Desert. Perhaps he truly felt bad about what had happened, but to force Sam to buy it. The clock chimed 11, and Arabin let out a long breath. I have a meeting. He waved a ringed hand to the tinkerer. Give the bill to my manservant when you're done. The master tinkerer nodded, still measuring Selena. Arabin approached her, each step as graceful as the movement of a dance. He planted a kiss on the top of her head. I'm glad to have you back, he murmured it onto her hair. With that, he strolled from the room, whistling to himself. The tinkerer knelt to measure the length between her knee and boot tip, for whatever purpose that had. Selena cleared her throat, waiting until she was sure Arabin was out of earshot. If I were to give you a piece of spider silk, could you incorporate it into one of these uniforms? It's small, so I just want it placed around the heart. She used her hands to show the size of the material that she'd been given by the merchant in the desert city of Xandria. Spider silk was a near-mythical material made by horse-sized Stygian spiders, so rare that you had to brave the spiders yourself to get it, and they didn't trade in gold. No, they coveted things like dreams and memories and souls. The merchant she'd met had traded 20 years of his youth for 100 yards of it, and after a long, strange conversation with him, he'd given her a few square inches of spider silk. A reminder, he'd said, that everything has a price. The master tinkerer's bushy brows rose. I suppose. To the interior or exterior? I think the interior, he went on, answering his own question. If I sewed it into the exterior, the iridescence might ruin the stealth of the black. But it turned me blade. And it's just barely the right size to shield the heart. Oh, what I'd give for 10 yards of spider silk You'd be invincible, my dear. She smiled slowly. As long as it guards the heart. She left the tinkerer in the hall. Her suit would be ready the day after tomorrow. It didn't surprise her when she ran into Sam on her way out. She'd spotted the dummy that bore his own suit waiting for him in the training hall. Alone with her in the hallway, he examined her suit. She still had to change out of it and bring it back downstairs to the tinkerer so he could make his final adjustments in whatever shop he'd set up while he was staying here in Riffold. Fancy, Sam said. She made to put her hands on her hips, but stopped. Until she mastered the suit, she had to watch how she moved, or else she might skewer someone. Another gift? Is there a problem if it is? She hadn't seen Sam at all yesterday, but then again, she'd also made herself pretty scarce. It wasn't that she was avoiding him. She just didn't particularly want to see him if it meant running into Lysandra, too. But it seemed strange that he wasn't on any missions. Most of the other assassins were away on various jobs or so busy they were hardly at home. But Sam seemed to be hanging around the keep, or helping Lysandra and her madam. Sam crossed his arms. His white shirt was tight enough that she could see the muscles shifting beneath. Not at all. Though I'm a little surprised that you're accepting his gifts. How could you forgive him after what he did? Forgive him? I'm not the one cavorting with Lysandra and attending luncheons and doing whatever in the hell you spent your summer doing. Sam let out a low growl. You think I actually enjoy any of that? You weren't the one sent off to the Red Desert. Believe me, I would rather have been thousands of miles away. I don't believe you. How can I believe anything you say? His brows furrowed. What are you talking about? Nothing. None of your business. I don't want to talk about this, and I don't particularly want to talk to you, Sam Cortland. Then go ahead, he breathed. Go crawl back to Arabin's study and talk to him. Let it buy you presents and pet your hair and offer you the best paying missions we get. I won't take him long to figure out the price for your forgiveness. Not when... She shoved him. Don't you dare judge me! Don't you say one more word! A muscle feathered in his jaw. That's fine with me. You wouldn't listen anyway. Slanner Sardothian, Arabin Hamel. Just the two of you, inseparable until the end of the world. The rest of us might as well be invisible. That sounds an awful lot like jealousy, especially considering you had 3 uninterrupted months with him this summer. What happened? You failed to convince him to make you his favorite? Found you lacking, did he? Sam was in her face so quickly that she fought the urge to jump back. You know nothing about what this summer was like for me. Nothing, Selena. Good. I don't particularly care. His eyes were so wide that she wondered if she'd struck him without realizing it. At last, he stepped away, and she stormed past him. She halted when he spoke again. You want to know what price I asked for forgiving Arabin, Selena? She slowly turned. With the ongoing rain, the hall was full of shadows and light. Sam stood so still he might have been a statue. My price was his oath that he'd never lay a hand on you again. I told him I'd forgive him in exchange for that. She wished he'd punched her in the gut. It would have hurt less. Not trusting herself to keep from falling to her knees with shame right there, she just stalked down the hall. She didn't want to speak to Sam ever again. How could she look him in the eye? He'd made Arabin swear that for her. She didn't know what words could convey the mixture of gratitude and guilt. Hating him had been so much easier, and it would have been far simpler if he'd blamed her for Arabin's punishment. She had said such cruel things to him in the hallway. How could she ever begin to apologize? Arabin came to her room after lunch and told her to have a dress pressed. Donoval, he'd heard, was going to be at the theater that night, and with 4 days until his exchange, it would be in her best interest to go. She formulated a plan for stalking Donoval, but she wasn't proud enough to refuse Arabin's offer to use his box at the theater for spying, to see who Donoval spoke to, and who sat near him, who guarded him, and to see a classical dance performed with a full orchestra. Well, she'd never turned that down. But Arabin failed to say who would be joining them. She found out the hard way when she climbed into Arabin's carriage and discovered Lysandra and Sam waiting inside. With 4 days until her bidding, the young courtesan needed all the exposure she could get, Arabin calmly explained, and Sam was there to provide additional security. Selena dared a glance at Sam as she slumped onto the bench beside him. He watched her, his eyes wary, shoulders tensed, as if he expected her to launch a verbal attack right there, like she'd mock him for what he'd done. Did he really think she was that cruel? Feeling a bit sick, she dropped Sam's stare. Lysandra just smiled at Selena from across the carriage and linked her elbow through Arabin's. And that was chapter 2. Goodness, goodness, goodness. I just realized the name of the song that's playing right now. It's really funny. It is called I Will Become a Cat. That is very interesting. Let's see, how long is chapter 3? Yeah, we can get through chapter 3. Two attendants greeted them at Arabin's private box, taking their sodden cloaks and exchanging them for glasses of sparkling wine. Immediately, one of Arabin's acquaintances popped in from the hall to say hello, and Arabin, Sam, and Lysandra remained in the velvet-lined antechamber as they chatted. Selena, who had no interest in seeing Lysandra test out her flirting with Arabin's friend, strode in through the crimson curtain to take her usual seat closest to the stage. Arabin's box was on the side of the cavernous hall, near enough to the center so that she had a mostly unobstructed view of the stage and the orchestra pit, but still angled enough to make her look longingly at the empty royal boxes. All of them occupied the coveted center position, and all of them were vacant. What a waste. She observed the floor seats and the other boxes, taking in the glittering jewels, the silk dresses, the golden glow, sparkling wine in fluted glasses, the rumbling murmur of the mingling crowd. If there was one place where she felt the most at home, a place where she felt happiest, it was here, in this theater, with the red velvet cushions and the glass chandeliers and the gilded domed ceiling high, high above them. It had been a coincidence, had it been a coincidence or planning, that had led to the theater being constructed at the very heart of the city, a mere 20-minute walk from the Assassin's Keep. She knew it would be hard for her to adjust to her new apartment, which was nearly double the distance from the theater. A sacrifice she was willing to make, if she ever found the right moment to tell Arabin she was paying her debt and moving out. Which she would. Soon. She felt Arabin's easy, self-assured gait strutting across the carpet, and straightened as he leaned over her shoulder. "Donovan is straight ahead," Arabin whispered, his hot breath on her skin. "Third box from the stage, second row of seats." She immediately found the man she'd been assigned to kill. He was tall and middle-aged, with pale blonde hair and tan skin. Not particularly handsome, but not an eyesore either. Not heavy, but not toned. Aside from his periwinkle tunic, which, even from the distance, looked expensive, there was nothing remarkable about him. There were a few others in the box. A tall, elegant woman in her late 20s stood near the partition curtain, a cluster of men around her. She held herself like a noble. The no diadem glittered in her lustrous dark hair. "Life or Bardingo," Arabin murmured, following her gaze. Donovan's former wife, and the one who'd hired her. It was an arranged marriage. She wanted his wealth, and he wanted her youth. But when they failed to have children, and some of his less desirable behavior was revealed, she managed to get out of the marriage, still young, but far richer. It was smart of Bardingale, really. If she planned to have him assassinated, then pretending to be his friend would help keep fingers from pointing her way. Though Bardingale might have looked the part of a polite, elegant lady, Selena knew there had to be some ice-cold steel running through her veins, and an unyielding sense of dedication to her friends and allies, not to mention to the common rights of every human being. It was hard not to immediately admire her. "And the people around them?" Selena asked. Through a small gap in the curtains behind Donovan, she glimpsed three towering men, all clad in dark gray, all looking like bodyguards. "They're friends and investors. Bardingale and Donovan still have some joint businesses together. The three men in the back are his guards." Selena nodded, and might have asked him some other questions had Sam and Lysandra not filed into the box behind them, bidding farewell to Arabin's friend. There were three seats along the balcony rail, and three seats behind them. Lysandra, to Selena's dismay, sat next to her as Arabin and Sam took the rear seats. Oh, look how many people there are, Lysandra said. Her low-cut ice-blue dress did little to hide her cleavage as she craned her neck over the rail. Selena blocked out Lysandra's prattling as the courtesan began tossing out important names. Selena could sense Sam behind her, feel his gaze focus solely on the gold velvet curtains concealing the stage. She should say something to him, apologize or thank him, or just say something kind. She felt him tensing, as if he, too, wanted to say something. Somewhere in the theater, a gong began signaling the audience to take their seats. It was now or never. She didn't know why her heart thundered the way it did, but she didn't give herself a chance to second guess as she twisted to look at him. She glanced once at his clothes, and then said, "You look handsome." His brows rose, and she swiftly turned back around in her seat, focusing hard on the curtains. He looked better than handsome, but, well, at least she'd said one thing, nice thing. She'd tried to be nice. Somehow, it didn't make her feel that much better. Selena folded her hands in the lap of her blood-red gown. It wasn't cut nearly as low as Lysandra's, but with the slender sleeves and the bare shoulders, she felt particularly exposed to Sam. She'd curled and swept her hair over one shoulder, certainly not to hide the scar on her neck. Donovan lounged in his seat, eyes on the stage. How could a man who looked so bored and useless be responsible for not just the fate of several lives, but of his entire country? How could he sit in this theater and not hang his head in shame for what he was about to do to his fellow countrymen, and to whatever slaves would be caught up in it? The men around Bardingale kissed her cheeks and departed for their own boxes. Donovan's three thugs watched the men very, very closely as they left. Not lazy, bored guards then, Selena frowned. But then the chandeliers were hauled upward into the dome and dimmed, and the crowd quieted to hear the opening notes as the orchestra began playing. In the dark, it was nearly impossible to see Donovan. Sam's hand brushed her shoulder, and she almost jumped out of her skin as he brought his mouth close to her ear and murmured, "You look beautiful, though I bet you already know that." She most certainly did. She gave him a sidelong glare and found him grinning as he leaned back into his seat. Suppressing her urge to smile, Selena turned toward the stage as the music established the setting for them. A world of shadows and mist, a world where creatures and myths dwelled in the dark moments before dawn. Selena went still as the gold curtains drew back, and everything she knew and everything she was faded away into nothing. The music annihilated her. The dancing was breathtaking, yes, and the story it told was certainly lovely. A legend of a prince seeking to rescue his bride, and the cunning bird he captured to help him to do it. But the music, had there ever been anything more beautiful, more exquisitely painful? She clenched the arms of the seat, her fingers digging into the velvet as the music hurtled toward its finale, sweeping her away in the flood. With each beat of the drum, each trill of the flute, and blare of the horn, she felt all of it along her skin, along her bones. The music broke her apart and put her back together, only to rend her asunder again and again. And then the climax, the compilation of all the sounds she had loved best, amplified until they echoed into eternity. As the final note swelled, a gasp broke from her, setting the tears in her eyes spilling down her face. She didn't care who saw. Then silence. The silence was the worst thing she'd ever heard. The silence brought back everything around her. Applause erupted, and she was on her feet, crying still as she clapped until her hands ached. Selena, I didn't know you had a shred of human emotion in you, Lysandra leaned in to whisper. And I didn't think the performance was that good. Sam gripped the back of Lysandra's chair. Shut up, Lysandra. Arabin clicked his tongue in warning, but Selena remained clapping, even as Sam's defense sent a faint trickle of pleasure through her. The ovation continued for a while, with the dancers emerging from the curtain again and again to bow and be showered with flowers. Selena clapped through it all, even as her tears dried, even as the crowd began shuffling out. When she remembered to glance at Donovan, his box was empty. Arabin, Sam, and Lysandra left their box too, long before she was ready to end her applause. But after she finished clapping, Selena remained, staring toward the curtain stage, watching the orchestra begin to pack up their instruments. She was the last person to leave the theater. There was another party at the keep that night, a party for Lysandra and her madam, and whatever artists and philosophers and writers Arabin favored at the moment. Mercifully, it was confined to one of the drawing rooms, but laughter and music still filled the entirety of the second floor. On the carriage ride home, Arabin had asked Elena to join them, but the last thing she wanted to see was Lysandra being fawned over by Arabin, Sam, and everyone else, so she told him that she was tired and needed to sleep. She wasn't tired in the least, though. Emotionally drained, perhaps, but it was only 10:30, and the thought of taking off her gown and climbing into bed made her feel rather pathetic. She was Adrenaline's assassin. She freed slaves and stolen Assyrian horses and won the respect of the mute master. Surely, she could do something better than go to bed early. So she slipped into one of the music rooms, where it was quiet enough that she could only hear a burst of laughter every now and then. The other assassins were either at the party or off on some mission or another. Her rustling dress was the only sound as she folded back the cover of the pianoforte. She'd learned how to play when she was 10, under Arabin's orders that she find at least one refined skill other than ending lives, and had fallen in love immediately. Though she no longer took lessons, she played whenever she could spare a few minutes. The music from the theater still echoed in her mind, again and again the same cluster of notes and harmonies. She could feel them humming under the surface of her skin, beating in time with her heart, which she wouldn't give to hear the music once more. She played a few notes with one hand, frowned, adjusted her fingers, and tried again, clinging to the music in her mind. Slowly, the familiar melody began to sound right, but it was only a few notes, and it was the pianoforte, not an orchestra. She pounded the keys harder, working out the riffs. It was almost there, but not quite right. She couldn't remember the notes as perfectly as they sounded in her head. She didn't feel them the way she'd felt them only an hour ago. She tried again for a few minutes, but eventually slammed the lid shut and stalked from the room. She found Sam lounging against a wall in the hallway. Had he been listening to her fumble with the pianoforte this whole time? "Close, but not quite the same, is it?" he said. She gave him a withering look and started toward her bedroom, even though she had no desire to spend the rest of the night sitting in there by herself. "It must drive you mad, not being able to get it exactly the way you remember it." He kept pace beside her. His midnight blue tunic brought out the golden hues in his skin. "I was just fooling around," she said. "I can't be the best at everything, you know. It wouldn't be fair to the rest of you, would it?" Down the hall, someone had started a merry tune on the instruments in the gaming room. Sam chewed on his lip. "Why didn't you trail Donovan after the theater? Don't you have only 4 days left?" She wasn't surprised he knew. Her missions weren't usually that secret. She paused, still itching to hear the music once more. "Some things are more important than death." Sam's eyes flickered. "I know." She tried not to squirm as he refused to drop her stare. "Why are you helping Lysandra?" She didn't know why she asked it. Sam frowned. "She's not all that bad, you know. When she's away from other people, she's... better. Don't bite off my head for saying it, but even though you taunt her about it, she didn't choose this path for herself. Like us." He shook his head. "She just wants your attention, an acknowledgement of her existence." She clenched her jaw. Of course he'd spent plenty of time alone with Lysandra, and of course he'd find her sympathetic. "I don't particularly care what she wants. You still haven't answered my question. Why are you helping her?" He shrugged. "Because Arabin told me to, and said that I have no desire to have my face beaten to a pulp again. I'm not going to question him." He hurt you that badly too?" Sam let out a low laugh, but didn't reply until after a servant bustled past, carrying a tray full of wine bottles. They were probably better off talking in a room where they'd be less likely to be overheard, but the idea of being utterly alone with him made her pulse pound. "I was unconscious for a day and dozed on and off for 3 or more after that," Sam said. Selena hissed a violent curse. "He sent you to the Red Desert," Sam went on, his words soft and low. "But my punishment was having to watch him beat you that night." "Why?" Another question she didn't mean to ask. He closed the distance between them, standing near enough now that she could see the fine gold thread detailing on his tunic. "After what we went through in Skull's Bay, you should know the answer." She didn't want to know the answer, now that she thought about it. "Are you going to make a bid for Lysandra?" Sam burst out laughing. "Bid? Selena, I don't have any money. And the money that I do have is going toward paying back Arabin, even if I wanted to." "Do you want to?" He gave her a lazy grin. "Why do you want to know?" "Because I'm curious whether Arabin's beating damaged your brain, that's why." "Afraid she and I had a summer romance?" That insufferable grin was still there. She could have raked her nails down his face. Instead, she picked another weapon. I hope you did. I certainly enjoyed myself this summer. The smile faded at that. What do you mean? She brushed an invisible fleck of dust off her red gown. Let's just say that the son of the mute master was far more welcoming than the other silent assassins. It wasn't quite a lie. Elise had tried to kiss her, and she had basked in his attention. But she hadn't wanted to start anything between them. Sam's face paled. Her words had struck home, but it wasn't as satisfying as she thought it would be. Instead, the mere fact that it had affected him made her feel... Oh, why had she even said anything about Ilias? Well, she knew precisely why. Sam began to turn away, but she grabbed his arm. Help me with Donovan, she blurted. Not that she needed it, but this was the best she could offer him in exchange for what he'd done for her. I'll give you half the money. He snorted. Keep your money. I don't need it. Ruining yet another slave trade agreement will be enough for me. He studied her for a moment, his mouth quirking to the side. You're sure you want my help? Yes, she said. It came out a bit strangled. He searched her eyes for any sign of mockery. She hated herself for making him distrust her that much. But he nodded at last. Then we'll start tomorrow. We'll scope out his house, unless you've already done that. She shook her head. I'll come by your room after breakfast. She nodded. There was more she wanted to say to him, and she didn't want him to go. But her throat had closed up, too full of all those unspoken words. She made to turn away. Selena. She looked back at him, her red gown sweeping around her. His eyes shone as he flashed her a crooked grin. I missed you this summer. She met his stare unflinchingly, returning the smile as she said, I hate to admit it, Sam Cortland, but I missed your sorry ass too. He merely chuckled before he strode toward the party, his hands in his pockets. And that was chapter 3. And I think that's probably where we're going to have to call it tonight, because chapter 4 is quite long. And honestly, my throat is killing me, and so is my stomach.
I'm tired.
Yeah, and it's also getting kind of toasty in this room. Anyways, let us find someone quickly to raid, and I will stop the recording.